Hi there, my name is Everett Mohan. You might know me as Aspiring Spike on the internet. I'm back here today to record another modern video for Channel Fireball. Kamigawa Neon Dynasty is here, and there's tons of exciting new cards to be playing with. And like we saw in the last video with the Parhelion combo deck, a lot of these new Neon Dynasty cards have us taking a look at some older cards that have never really had a chance to shine in modern. And so this deck is trying to capitalize on the power of Consulate Dreadnought, a card that I feel like has always had a ton of potential. This is a one mana vehicle with 7 power, 11 toughness, and it crews for 6, which obviously the crew cost is super duper high on this card, but this card is just kind of begging to be broken, because if you can meet this card's really difficult deck building restrictions, you do get a pretty high power level payoff. And so the new card that's been printed to power up Dreadnought is the land Mech Hanger. For 3 and tapping the Mech Hanger, basically 4 mana, you can crew your Consulate Dreadnought and get in there for 7. And so, while I don't think that just putting Mech Hanger in your deck is good enough to make Dreadnought a powerful card by itself, what Mech Hanger does is it really like raises the floor on Dreadnought. So, if your opponents kill all your other creatures and you have no way to crew Dreadnought, then at the very least, with 4 Mech Hangers, you're pretty likely to be able to still spend 4 mana to get in for 7 and really put a lot of pressure on your opponent. That being said, you don't usually crew the Dreadnought with Mech Hanger. Just like this just raises the floor on the card a little bit. The main ways you're actually crewing Dreadnought in this deck are either with a token from Nettlecyst, a token from Urza's Saga, or it's pretty common in these affinity decks, you'll be playing out a few of your cheap artifacts on turns 1, turn 2, then turn 3, turn 4. You're going to play like 2 Mirror Enforcers, Mirror Enforcer Companion, Mirror Enforcer Frogmite, which can combine to crew your Dreadnought. And so it's kind of like you're giving these big, giant artifact monsters haste, and you're able to just attack a turn sooner, often take a turn off the clock, which I found pretty valuable. You can also do a few different tricks with Cranial Plating Nettlecyst, where you can like crew the Dreadnought with your equipped creature, then move the equipment over, sometimes to the Dreadnought if you want, and you know, kind of like get 2 equips out of the equipment in one turn. That's probably not the best way to put it, but I hope you know what I mean. And so I found this deck to be very strong. I've played probably 6 leagues of the deck at the time of making this video. I've really liked the deck so far. There's obviously a lot of new artifact brews to be messing around with, and the reality is a lot of these decks are playing like slow, dirtily, grindy card advantage value cards, and those are really fun, but this is an aggro deck, and this is an aggro deck that's going to kill your opponent and kill them quickly. And I found this deck to be really powerful, and to be honest, like the most promising of all the like affinity variants I've tried so far. Just a couple more notes on the deck's construction. This list is colorless, or basically completely colorless, since when you're including Mech Hanger, you're playing Saga, you really want to play all these artifact lands. You can splash a color, but I think the list is so much cleaner being colorless, and I think that this build really wants to stay mono brown. That being said, we do have 1 basic land in the deck for Baseiju, Field of Ruin, Path to Exile. I have like the 1 basic land. I started off with 4 Factory, and I'm just like, I got Baseiju'd in Field of Ruined a couple times. So we went ahead and added the mountain for our companion Gigantha. Gigantha does come up sometimes, especially against decks playing Force of Vigor, but it's really not that big a deal. You could play a swamp instead for your cranial platings, but you need 2 black sources, so you have to have like a drum and your swamp. It just doesn't come up that often. Emrakul for mill, Gutshots for Ragavan deck, Stamping Sphere for big mana and some spell-based combo deck like Belcher. Relic for Graveyard Hate, Welding Jar for Artifact Destruction, and then Needle as a Saga target that's good against, like Yawgmoth, Engineered Explosives. So this is the deck. I've really been liking it. It's pretty straightforward, but I did write a guide for this deck for CFB Pro, so if you are interested in this list, you like the video, you can check out a more in-depth guide over there. A lot of great content over there beyond just that one article too. And before we jump into the league, I want to remind you guys that this video is brought to you by the new Channel Fireball Marketplace. You can buy Magic singles there, support your local game stores, and you can also support me if you want to use code SPIKE at checkout. But without any further ado, we can go ahead and jump into a league. Okay, we are on the draw for the first match of this league. It's a pretty interesting hand here. For basic mountain. Playing against a non-companion deck. So they can play Dreadnought on turn one or Springleaf Drum. I feel like this hand has got a lot of potential in the draw. I'm gonna try it. I'm not 100% sure that this is supposed to be a keep or a mulligan, but I do think this hand is very close to, like, you know, we just need like one more cheap creature, and then it's like much easier to cast this Mirror Enforcer. And then, you know, something that I found with Cranial Plating and Dreadnought is if you have two creatures, you get to put a plating on one, use it to crew the Dreadnought, then move the plating onto another creature and attack with both. My opponent's gone ahead and mulled to five. This is something else I've also come to learn playing these affinity decks is that they don't necessarily mulligan that well. You know, cards like Mirror Enforcer, Frogmite, Cranial Plating do need you to have a density of cards. So when you have a reasonable but somewhat borderline keep like this, I do think that you're pretty incentivized to try to justify yourself keeping a hand like this. Okay, opponents, yeah, definitely got some tricky mulligan decisions over there. They've gone ahead and gone to five, but they put two cards back, and they've revealed Chancellor of the Tangle. We could be dead on turn one, facing down a Neoform. My opponent could also do nothing here. Yeah, definitely seems like, you know, they don't have the absolute. No, they would need Allosaurus Rider Neoform here to kill me. And they. Okay, despite my worst fears, my opponent has actually, instead of killing me, it looks like they may actually do nothing this entire game. That is modern for you. So yeah, I've got five artifacts. Ooh. I think I'm actually going to be, so I see five. Oh, no, so that's, exactly enough to crew this Dreadnought, actually. I think I'm going to have a turn three kill here. Smack him for seven. That'll say, yeah, definitely a turn three kill. One shy of playing the Mirror Enforcer here. Okay. I probably should have done a better job explaining this. My opponent is playing Neobrand Combo. Their goal is to cast a card called Allosaurus Rider, which is a 7-mana creature that they can pay by exiling two green cards from their hand. It has text on it. You don't really need to know anything beyond that. And then they're going to sacrifice that 7-mana creature that costs them 0 mana to a Neoform Eldritch Evolution to put a Gristlebrand into play. They're going to use that Gristlebrand to draw their entire deck, gaining life with Nourishing Shoal along the way. And once they draw their entire deck, they're going to cast a Laboratory Maniac and win the game. They cast a Laboratory Maniac via Mox Amber, which makes black mana off Gristlebrand. They've got a few different ways of turning that black mana into blue mana for Laboratory Maniac. So I'm going to bring in this Pithing Needle so I can name it Gristlebrand. Damping Sphere is also relevant against them, where it does hurt their mana generation. It stops them. If they cast Allosaurus Rider, if they want to cast Neoform, it costs them more and more mana. And then it also means that they probably can't kill you the turn they get Gristlebrand, but I don't know that this deck can beat a Gristlebrand. I guess it actually can. Let's get a big creature with a Shadow Spear. Yeah, I think I'll just cut a Bauble for a Pithing Needle. I'm not prepared for this matchup. I think that's going to be okay. Maybe I actually want more Welding Jars, but my opponent brings in Force of Negation. Let's just cut more Baubles. This is something. This is also like a somewhat reasonable plan against Neobrand. Like, you saw game one, they mulled a five, and then they really weren't able to do anything. Neobrand is definitely a deck that has a relatively high fail rate. Probably mulled a six. Yeah, I'm going to keep this. Yeah, Neobrand is a deck that has a pretty high fail rate, and so just kind of hoping that your opponent doesn't have it is like actually a pretty reasonable game plan. Or at least it's the game plan we've got. Okay, so I can go Trezorfall, Dreadnought, Minmite, and then next turn I can go spend one mana for Frogmite. I might play Sog on turn one. That stops me from making any tokens, but it maybe lets me needle Gristlebrand. Yeah, I think that like trying to needle Gristlebrand is feels worthwhile with this hand. I feel like this is a hand that might actually be able to beat a Gristlebrand. Dreadnought attacks through it, Nettle Cyst attacks through it potentially. Okay, Nature's Claim my Saga. I go up to 24 life, but I've got to say that anything they do that's not combo killing me is okay with me. They do spend, yeah, it looks like they might combo kill me here though. Yeah, they did have Rider, green card land, Neoform as their unknowns. So here comes the Gristlebrand. We could maybe let them start to go off so we can show what this chain is like. It is possible for them to brick. They do need to find Nourishing Shoal in order to gain enough life to keep drawing cards. That being said, I don't really feel like we're gonna be able to beat just like the regular old Gristlebrand here. They did find a Nourishing Shoal, pitching a Turn Timber Symbiosis to gain 7. And they found another Nourishing Shoal, this time exiling Autochron Worm to gain 15 life up to 18. Now they can draw 14 more cards. Down to 17 cards in their library. Man, turn 2 kill with the Nature's Claim is pretty good. We're just gonna have to hope to get kind of lucky on the play. This is definitely a matchup you don't want to run into. Yeah. So they use Springleaf Drum. So sometimes you'll see like Pinted Prism instead, but this version uses Springleaf Drum to get their blue mana. They do need to show me that they can gain more life here, I guess. Because if their other two Nourishing Shoals are in like the bottom 16 cards, they might actually fizzle here. Whoa, Thrasta. Why do they play Thrasta? Are they gonna maybe kill me? Okay, hold on. Whoa. Fortifying Draught, gain 2 life. Target creature gets +X/+X, where X is the amount of life you gain this turn. So this is a 31-31 Trample Haste. Okay, I will block. Soak up a damage. All right, let's go to game 2. Okay, I haven't seen that be the win condition of choice. I don't know. Well, if that's the win kind of choice, maybe I do want Damping Spheres. Yeah, I think that logic checks out to me. Probably gonna trim a couple enforcers. They're kind of maybe a little slow in this this matchup, huh? Either way, gonna be a pretty fast round one. Got a mulligan this hand. We do have a Damping Sphere, but just like basically no pressure beyond that. Okay, so this hand can go turn 1 Gingerbird, turn 2 1 mana Frogmite. Then we can't play the enforcer. I think we're gonna go to 5. Okay, this hand we can work with. So I probably put back Welding Jar, Nettle Cyst. Nettle Cyst seems pretty important to winning. Maybe I could put back the Mountain, hope to draw a Mana Source or a 0 mana artifact. Could also put back the Damping Sphere, I guess. Yeah, I know the Damping Sphere would have been, you know, okay that game. My opponent kept 6 cards. I know the Damping Sphere would have been okay that game. That being said, I do feel the most important thing is putting pressure on my opponent, and I'm not gonna win this game if I'm not able to put pressure on my opponent. Because at the end of the day, like what's important about this matchup is like. Is being able to pressure their life total, I think, so they can't gain a lot of life off Gristlebrand. And then like us keeping this like pretty slow hand on the mold of 5 is you know definitely not ideal. Maybe I can hope that my opponent's draw is not very good, but it looks like it's gonna be good enough here. Yeah, Springleaf Drum looks pretty good. Just as like an extra mana generation for these Allosaurus Rider turns. And then I think I'm probably just going to concede here. I think that there's really not a reality where we beat this Gristlebrand. I'm not sure how much we're supposed to read into this match, but we are starting this video at 0-1. Okay, we are on the draw for match number two. Hand definitely has too many lands, so we're going to send it back. Hand has a pretty good ratio of lands and spells. I think I'll keep this and put back the Nettlesys, since we've got the Saga. Saga basically makes, you know, two Nettlesys tokens. Yeah, obviously not exactly, but close enough. Basic Plains go. I think I'll play out both Ornithopters. It can be good to hold them. It can be good not to hold them. I got kind of wrecked by a Void Mirror in a sideboard game recently by holding an Ornithopter early. Obviously, this is not a sideboard game, so that's probably not going to really be a factor. I'm like just a little paranoid from that experience. I'm just going to go ahead and play a Cranial Plating past the turn. They're going to go for activating Stoneforge Mystic rather than Field of Ruining my Urza Saga, which I'm kind of surprised by, to be honest. Okay. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I'm one mana short of, or one artifact short of Activate Saga. Activate Saga, cast Companion. They've got this Field of Ruin, so I kind of feel like I'm supposed to play my Urza Saga here to make their Field of Ruin worse. Maybe just double count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, one short. So we are going to take another big hit off of this Kaldra token, admittedly. It's going to be tricky to race this. We'll see what happens. Glad I made the right play with the playing the Saga over the Mistress Factory. It's also true that the basic mountain is coming in clutch here. Okay, gonna just take the five for now. I'm trying to think, do I want to pop this bobble or not? I think that my mana is like pretty accounted for here. Yeah, I'm gonna make a token, equip plating. Yeah, so I think that Incast Companion, which just uses all my mana exactly. So I'm just gonna leave the bobble in play. Attack my opponent back for 16. I've got the Shadow Spear coming down next turn. If I'm able to obviously equip that to a construct and attack, then we win the race. You know, we survived this attack. I'm feeling pretty good about our chances to, you know, just to win the race. They do attack. Okay, I'm really surprised to see this. I'm gonna take five down to five. Lee and an Arbiter. Okay, so I cannot get. Okay, I cannot get anything off the Saga. I mean, I can't. So I can double pay, but then I can't do anything with it. I can't equip the Shadow Spear. But I could pay for both Arbiters. Let's go ahead and pop the bobble. See, next turn they're drawing a Path to Exile. That is actually a very scary card to see, but I guess a good one to know about. Okay, and then let's, I guess, make a token. Cast Dreadnought. Oh, sorry, cast Bobble. If I cast Dreadnought, I can animate this, and then these each are going to have 11 power. Man, it really stinks I can't make each of these lethal. But if I go, so they're going to go down to, they're going down to three off the Ornithopter, or, you know, actually one off the Ornithopter. Oh, they're dead, right? Yeah, they're dead. They take both of these, then they block, and they die from the companion. I guess it was actually more damage to attack with the factory, but. Lethal's lethal. If they have solitude, I'm also, like, you know, fine, because I get to gain 11 life. They do have solitude. Okay. Wait, they're exiling the companion? An interesting decision. So they go down to two, but I'm at nine, so like they're not winning the race with the Cauldre token. They're in his path to exile two mystery cards, and yeah, they just pack it in. I was gonna maybe try to crew and try to chump block, but I think it matters too much, I guess. I probably want this needle. I don't want the welding jar against all the exile-based removal. Gutshot kills Kitaki if they've got Kitaki, which is pretty relevant. But I don't know. I'm not sure that they have Kitaki. It's probably a good time to be playing it, I guess. Let's submit this. Let's submit this. If they've got Kitaki, we'll try to beat a game three. If they've got it, maybe they won't draw it. I don't love being super in on Urza Saga in a matchup like this where they've got a lot of answers to Urza Saga. That being said, I don't I like I mentioned earlier, I do think that you're pretty incentivized in this deck to try to keep hands, to try to keep hands that are at least somewhat reasonable. And I think this hand is reasonable enough to keep. I think it's better to play Gingerbread on turn one for the damage. Could be better to play Dreadnought. Oh, they target the Ornithopter? Okay. Works out for me. Let's play the Saga. Dreadnought, Shadow Spear. So next turn we can play Treasure Vault, and then we're gonna have one, two, three, four, five artifacts. So by tapping Gingerbread and the Construct, we can crew the Dreadnought next turn. Okay, let's bring in some gut shots. I'll just bring in some gut shots, you know. I'll be dead to Kentucky. It's this is I think the good attitude to have as an affinity pilot. Just accept your death to Kentucky sometimes. Yeah, let me try my Frogmite and then two Enforcers for these gut shots. Yeah, never lost to a Kentucky before, kid. Must be nice. I was losing to Kitaki before you were born. This hand's close. This hand's really close. So we can go Citadel, Drum. Then we play Bauble. The next turn, we can go Dreadnought, zero mana Frogmite. Yeah, I think this hand's a keep. I mean, obviously it's like not gonna beat a Kitaki, but maybe we'll draw the gut shot, right? Just trying to think if I should play the Bauble or not, or crack the Bauble or not. You know, it is true that if I crack the Bauble, I'm gonna be able to likely find another cheap artifact, maybe more likely to find a land this turn. But this does guarantee the affinity, which is pretty important. And see, now I've got the ability to play one mana companion here. Okay, so I'm probably gonna pop the Bauble end of turn. Relic Warder, okay. Not Kitaki, so this is fine. We've got a Cauldre on top, so not drawing Kitaki next turn. Probably drawing their worst draw step two. Oh, they go after the Citadel. Okay, that's pretty interesting. Kind of, I think it's probably a fine play by them. Let's get him for six. Or I guess I can actually. I can crew like this. I can offer the trade of Frogmite for Relic Warder, which they probably won't take. Yeah, but they are gonna take nine. Drew Cauldre for turn. Weird match. Weird league so far. Weird. Get a batter skull. Okay. Just gonna play this plating post combat. And then try to kill them with the gingerbread. Oh no, Cauldron blocks gingerbread next turn. Okay, so I guess I'll just make the same attack I did last time first. Cast the cranial plating post combat, and we'll go from there. Okay, they take the trade this time. So now I do get to equip. Just trying to think. I think I might actually equip onto. We'll just equip onto the Ornithopter. Could maybe be better to equip onto Midmite, because then I can crew the Dreadnought with Midmite than Ornithopter. Might just be good no matter what. Or Kataki gets us, I think. Oh, but they don't got it. We win the match. Pretty fast league so far. I'll see you guys in round number 3. Okay, we are on the draw for round number 3. Got a hand that is all mana, no gas. Okay, we're definitely going to keep this 6-card hand. Probably put back the basic mountain. Pretty easy call, I think. 0-mana artifact creature could potentially give us the nut draw or close to the nut draw where we get to go Saga, Springleaf Drum, 0-mana creature, Dreadnought, and then crew the Dreadnought on turn 2. Looks like my opponent's playing the Boros Stoneblade deck I've been working on. A deck that I definitely like a lot. Here, I think I'm going to play the Factory, because I could potentially block with the Factory next turn. I'll play the Dreadnought, and then I'm probably going to crack this Bauble too. Notably, the Boros deck is a Blood Moon deck, so if we get Blood Moon on turn 3, our Saga is going to die. So they've got a prismatic ending for my Springleaf Drum, which is not the end of the world with this hand. I also have a Solitude on the top of their library. They attack me for 1 down to 18. Another copy of Saga. All right, let's play the Dreadnought. I know I can try to block with the Factory, but if they do have a sword plus equip, it's just a chump block anyways. It looks like they don't have it. Attack me for 1 and no third land. This is huge. Huge news. Okay, so I can play the Treasure Vault, and then I'll have a 3-3 blocker. I can also play a Factory, though. And so if I play Factory, I can actually block with a 4-4. So like playing Factory is pretty good against them having a sword. So I think that's what I want to do, is play the Factory here. Because I can make the Factory a creature, then have the Factory pump itself, then have the other Factory pump the first Factory. But with this attack, I mean, I'm just easily going to just put the 2-2 in front of the 1-1. If they're playing anything similar to my list, there's actually just like not really any trick I get got by here. I wonder if they just forgot I had the Dreadnought in play. That could definitely be. Oh, Fury pitch Blood Moon to kill my Construct. Well, I'll take the 3-for-1 or 3-for-0. I don't know. I'll take it. Whatever it is, I'm taking it here. Okay, so we've got a 2-2 Construct, then a 3-3 after whatever we decide to get here, which is, let's see, 3-3, 4-4, 5-5. So yeah, let me actually get Gingerbread so that I can crew the Dreadnought this turn. Which is just really important to, give this Construct haste, get 7 damage in. I know they have Solitude, but if they Solitude my Dreadnought, I am thrilled, actually. Third land, so they might Blood Moon me. Blood Moon would actually be pretty good here. Okay, we win. Oh, no, sorry, they do have the Solitude. All right, premature. Premature, I win. That being said, we're doing all right. I like this deck a lot. I know that we got crushed by the combo deck round 1, but that is something that's going to happen with a deck like this. But this deck has been really powerful so far. I've been pretty excited by it. Okay, I definitely want Gutshot against the Fervent Champion, Esper Sentinel, Ragavan deck. Pithy Needle's pretty good against them too. Let's go ahead and cut the Welding Jar. I guess they do bring in Wear Tear. Doesn't regenerate Saga is kind of a problem. I'll play the first Bauble over the first Welding Jar over the first Bauble. I think you could maybe cut the Baubles from this deck. They are okay. I like them more in this deck than a lot of the other Affinity shells I've been trying, where it gives you Affinity early for your Frogbite Mirror Enforcer, then you get to cycle it for a card. But I do kind of feel like it's like clearly the weakest card in the deck at the same time. So don't be surprised if you see me cut it, I guess. All right, this would be so good if this were an artifact land. I'm going to try it, though, especially on the draw where we're, like, you know, somewhat likely to draw another cheap artifact, which, you know, makes the rest of my Affinity hand pretty good. Matching Mountains. Gutshot would also be a welcome draw, potentially. Oh, did draw an artifact land. So this is going to allow me to turn one, play one of my two 1-mana spells into Frogmite. Should probably just be the Dreadnought, right? Because I can go Companion Crew the Dreadnought next turn. And I've got a 2-2 to block their 1-1. Fury would be kind of bad, I guess. Ooh, love these basics so much. Oh, Gutshot looking good too. So yeah, Shadow Spear discounts the Companion. This is 2-mana. Oh, 1-mana. Perfect. Oh, I guess about the same, actually. But we do get to Crew the Dreadnought. Man, this deck has been an absolute treat to play. Get in 4-7. Okay. But they've got the Wear Tear. I mean, you know, this is part of playing Affinity. Getting got by sideboard cards, just hoping to fight through. Hoping my opponent plays Sword, goes for Sword Equip, and I get to Gutshot. That would be really ideal. So they go for a Ranger Captain. For another copy of Fervent Champion. Decide not to attack there. We draw a Welding Jar, which is pretty interesting. I could equip the Shadow Spear here now. Yeah, I think I like equipping the Spear to the Frogmite. And then I kind of think my opponent's going to go double block on the Companion, and I can Gutshot and blow them out in combat. This is also, I think, a fine outcome. Although, I was probably supposed to Welding Jar the Frogmite, actually. Pretty bad if they exile this. I mean, the Welding Jar still gets to stay in play, have some applications. Yeah, so second Fervent Champion is pretty bad for me here, actually. They got a Batterskull where I can Gutshot one of them, but that's the second one's going to just be able to equip onto itself. So I think I should just Gutshot now. I mean, maybe it's saving Gutshot to Gutshot after a Batterskull equip was better. But if they have a Sword here, then like my Gutshot's not really doing anything. Nettlesys is a great draw, though. Nettlesys is hopefully going to be a game-winning draw. They exile the Germ token with a Prismatic Ending. I'm actually surprised, because I feel like the Shadow Spear is maybe a bit more threatening. Looks like they mistapped with the Stoneforge Mystic. So yeah, they're going to put a Sword on their Fervent Champion. But if they just put Sword on Fervent Champion... Okay, they put Batterskull into play. I was thinking, yeah, if they just put Sword on Fervent Champion equip, they're just dead on board. And so it looks like their plan is to Chump Block and then move this over next turn. This is a very interesting draw. Yeah, let's just cast another Nettlesys. So yeah, I'm going to have a pretty effective block here, I hope. Does cost them 2 mana to equip. Another Stoneforge Mystic. I don't know what they're getting with this. A land would be really nice. Just go equip. Get a Cauldra. Yeah, but they don't have the land to Stoneforge Mystic and the second copy of Cauldra. They also don't have good attacks. I need a land right here, right now, pretty badly. Okay, not a land. Not a land, but I'm still going to go for the Shadow Spear equip, cast Ginger Root to grow the Nettle Cyst, attack for 10, force some blocks. Okay, so they're going to gain 4, take 6, down to 8. A land would be bad for me because they get to go put in, untap land, but they would put in Cauldra, equip. I don't know why you would main face with the Cauldra in. That's a couple times they've done this. It's been a bit weird. The line detects that the first strike plus exile creature is pretty tough for me here, though. Oh, they started to pay costs. I think they're probably just trying to equip and realizing that they can't. So what I can do here is, I guess, what in the world is this attack? Okay, they must have a removal spell, right? But I get to go. Oh, the Fervent Champions can block the Ginger Brute too. I should probably maybe set out Ginger Brute. Maybe setting out Ginger Brute's the line. Do I even activate it? Probably not. I think I'm just gonna sit in with these guys. Assume they've got something and they didn't just throw away the game. Oh, they just threw away the game. Okay. Definitely a little bit of an experience on that board state for my opponent. This has been a super fast league so far. 2-1. Having some really fun, really interesting games, I feel. Let's see if we can continue that the rest of the league. Okay, I think this is the first die roll we've won this league. Just, definitely something the Affinity deck is really interested in doing is winning some die rolls. I definitely like this hand well enough to keep it. Obviously, artifact-based decks love Urza Saga. If this was a zero mana creature and not Welding Jar, this hand would be like, close to the nut draw, where again you get to play Dreadnought on turn 1, then Springleaf draw, then make a token, crude Dreadnought on turn 2, which is super, super powerful when it happens. I think I'll just play the Drum on turn 1, although I also don't think it likely matters that much. This is game 1. I imagine they don't have, any one mana shatters in their deck game 1. If they do, we're in trouble, probably. They do suspend an Ancestral Vision, a card that doesn't see that much play in Modern, to be honest. A card that I remember buying. I remember, desperately clamoring. It feels kind of embarrassing in retrospect, but I was clamoring to get my hands on 4 Ancestral Visions in time for FNM. I needed them. I needed the visions. I needed them. And I did get them, and they weren't that good. And, it's like 6 or 7 years later, and my opponent is still trying them out. One thing I just noticed is we haven't actually crewed Dreadnought with Mech Hanger yet. Crewing Dreadnought with Mech Hanger is something that I've done. Oh, is this wrong too? No, it's fine. Yeah, I have crewed Dreadnought with Mech Hanger several times, but I find that like what Mech Hanger mostly does in the deck, and you can find some more thoughts on this on in the guide I wrote for CFB Pro actually. But what Dreadnought does in this deck is, or sorry, what Mech Hanger does for Dreadnought is it like really raises the floor of Dreadnought. Where like the floor of Dreadnought is like oftentimes that like you just don't have any creatures in play to crew it. It raises that floor if you draw Mech Hanger to be, tap 4 mana to crew it instead. Which is really important for a card like Dreadnought, where you see in a spot like this, Dreadnought, it can be really powerful and, it can do stuff like it's doing this game and some games. it can be, made awkward by your opponent's removal. Fast league so far. I'm going to bring in some Welding Jars, I think, just for baubles. don't really know exactly what they're doing. You gotta imagine they're playing like Asphritold and stuff, but I don't have like any, you can't really, it's hard to play Chalice and Voidmirror in this deck, so hard to have too much Cascade hate. You could maybe play Chalice, but you have a lot of zero mana cards at top deck, but it is true that you will run out the zero mana cards in your hand before you play your Chalice on zero, so maybe it's fine to play Chalice. Okay, I'll keep this. Good looking hand. Kind of slow though, and on the draw. Yeah, so next turn, I'll probably main phase make a token so I can cast Frogmite for zero. We'll see what happens. You know, yeah, if they abrade my cranial plating, we don't have that option. See, maybe they're going to cast like an Asphritold here. Iteration. Pretty classic mistake. You'll see players make is playing your land before iteration. You're going to want to hold that to potentially play off of it. And as you see here, my opponent exiles a mountain to the iteration and they just can't play it. So a good lesson for you to learn. And now I actually drew a zero mana artifact. So I do get to play the Frogmite this turn. So we'll go ahead and do that. Two artifacts short of the Enforcer, but thankfully Urza Saga is going to give us two more artifacts for our turn. Second copy of Sulphur Falls. So I'm not sure what I'm getting off of the Urza Saga here. Potentially Springleaf Drum. I did just draw Drum for turn. Could get another Welding Jar. I already have one in play. Probably not necessary. Let's get a Dreadnought. Yeah, let's just get a Dreadnought. Then our Saga tokens are going to be able to crew the Dreadnought. Maybe like Cryptic Command? I don't know. We'll see what happens. Petty Theft? Okay. Goodbye, Construct. Thankfully, we've got a few more Urza Saga tokens where that came from. When it is going to take 2 down to 16. We can present Lethal next turn pretty easily, actually. But they have 5 cards in their hand. A lot of mana. Tapped copy of Steam Vents. Snap a braid, main phase. I'm assuming a braid. Iteration, yeah. I guess the Welding Jar makes the braid a lot worse. Second time though, they've played their land before their iteration, which is not a sign of personal growth, not a sign that they're learning their lesson necessarily. And they exile another land. It's okay. Happy accidents. Learning opportunities. Oh, whoops, sorry, this doesn't have the ability yet. All right, let's make the token. Crew the constructs. Or sorry, crew the Dreadnought. So they're gonna block here. They take 11, 13. Just trying to think if I want to tap the Frogbite to cast the plating. I think I'd rather just deal them the extra 2 damage. Dreadnought hits so hard. Okay, put us down to 3 life. We've got a giant board. Shattering Spree or Shatterstorm is a modern legal card, though. They can also like combo off. I know they showed us Visions game 1. I don't know if they've got like a Taking Turns deck or something. Okay, now Okay, another iteration, another land played before casting iteration. And a concession. Okay, this is maybe going to be the fastest video I ever record for Channel Fireball. We're off to a nice 3-1 after our 0-1 loss to Neobrand. Let's see if we can finish strong in round number 5. Okay, so we are, in fact, lucky enough to win the last die roll for this league. We're on the play against Aluris deck. We could keep this hand and go turn 1, draw Midmite, then turn 2, cycle Companion, but I'm going to mulligan instead. Okay. I don't love this hand, but we're probably going to keep. Let's put back Welding Jar. Might actually crew a Dreadnought with a mech hanger this game. Okay, so probably playing against Hammer Time, which I admittedly have found to be a pretty bad matchup, to be honest. I think it happened, though. I have actually, like, you know, I have made, like, I have just, like, overpowered them a couple times playing against them. Just, like, made bigger creatures. Like, double Nettlesist and Shadow Spear equipped to a creature. Lavinia. What? Lavinia actually, like... Okay, hold on. Each opponent can't cast non-creature spells with mana value greater than the number of lands they control. So Companion lets me do that. Opponent casts a spell with no mana spent to counter that spell. Okay. So this costs me 4. Probably don't want to play Nettlesist and let them draw, although I do get to attack with the Dreadnought. Let's let them draw. This uses my mana like by far the most efficiently and allows me to attack for 7 pretty comfortably here, so just gotta be the line, right? So I gotta make sure not to spend 0 mana on this. Thankfully, Nettlesist is giving me a count of the number of artifacts I have. Okay, find Stoneforge Mystic. So are they not playing Midmite? Oh, this only affects opponents. Right. I could trade here. I think that at this point in the game, I probably don't want to. Cast the hammer. Okay, so this is going to make 5. Oh, right. Well, no harm, no foul. Okay, maybe a little harm and a little foul. Okay, I'm going to animate the factory. And then, oh, sorry. I was still doing the Midmite calculations. Just embarrassing, to be honest. But I was still calculating my companion costs as if I had the Midmite in play. So, I mean, I still get to do everything I wanted to do. But I just have tapped one more mana that I wasn't going to use anyways, I guess. All right, but yeah, but despite fumbling through the main deck Lavinia, we're not doing so bad. Okay, they do get to equip a hammer here. However, we can just take 12. It might be better to sacrifice the Midmite. So I'm going to move this over here. I think I'll let this go because I might actually want to go like crew with this and crew with the token and then move the Nettlesist over so I can attack with multiple creatures here. Okay, that's going to get countered, so I can go animate Mishra's Factory. Animate Mishra's Factory, crew the Dreadnought, and then I can move the Nettlesist over to Midmite or another creature here. I'm going to have 2 lethal attackers, the Dreadnought and then the Midmite, and then they have to block both of those and then they still take 6. So assuming my opponent does not have main deck removal, which I don't think is too likely with the main deck Lavinia, we should get the job done here. Cool game. Dreadnought too strong, hopefully. Let's go. I do think this matchup's not good, but I also have beaten it every time I've played against it. I think I said something pretty similar to this last video, but like, yeah, this is not me like backhandedly saying the matchup's good. I do genuinely believe that we're not favored, but you could get lucky and win, and I have been getting lucky and winning. Still have the rest of the match to go though. Sade wants a Springleaf drum so badly. I'm definitely keeping this hand, though. Definitely keeping. I'm definitely running out both Midmites in turn one to not get got by Lavinia. See what their turn one play is. Hopefully it's not too fast. Oh, run as fast as you can. So we're going to play two Thopters, Treasure Vault, Dreadnought. Our turn two, maybe, you know, just Urza Saga, Dreadnought. But turn three, things hopefully start getting powerful. Our Urza Saga is probably going to be a little bit better than theirs. Okay, and then their turn two is also really bad. Just activating the Ginger Brute. Easy deal. Ooh, but now they have Sigarda's Aid to go with their... Urza Saga, which is scary. And a hammer on top. Okay, it's not looking too good. We could draw Gutshot. One time. Oh my gosh, I'm so glad this is a video. I'm so glad this is a recording, huh? They don't like that. Yeah, I mean, surely they're going for the hammer here, right? Activate. Yeah, there's no way they don't go for it. And like, there's got to be no way they have another hammer too. Yes. Like I said, sometimes you can play a bad matchup and you can just get a little lucky, huh? Just a teensy tiny bit of luck. Okay, so I can play plating, make a token. It could be maybe better to play Nettlesist than to make a token. I think I'll play the Nettlesist instead of making a token, since like I don't think like number of tokens in play is gonna be the determining factor of winning this match. And then like the Nettlesist has just a little bit of more utility, you know. Game's also not over. They do get to make a construct and put a hammer on that if they want. But you know, I can maybe move the Nettlesist over to the Ornithopter. And then if I draw a land, I can go get Springleaf Drum and then also attach a plating to an Ornithopter and win that way. See what happens. Yeah, the only way they can get a hammer on the off of the saga, if they want to put a hammer on something off the saga trigger, they have to make a token, which, you know, of course taps them out for the turn. Okay, so they get a needle, and they're probably going to name Dreadnoughts. Yeah, they do name Dreadnought. Pretty good against their deck. They go Paladin. They don't have Metalcrafts. Yeah, it looks like they were trying to equip it now. They're realizing they don't have Metalcraft. They do have two cards in their hand. But it looks like neither of those cards are going to help them solve their Metalcraft problem, I guess. Okay, so I can make a token here. I really want to force a chump block. Making a going for cranial plating definitely forces a chump block. Yeah, I think we just go for cranial plating here, actually. And then grab a ginger brute. And they just pack it in. Man, that was such a lucky gut shot. I can't believe it. Okay, we 4-1 that league after losing to Neobrand. I feel like this is a pretty good indicator of my experience with this deck so far, where I haven't been winning against like the super fast combo decks. Obviously, I do feel like you're capable of racing some of them, but you know, Neobrand is definitely the out goldfishy deck. And then, you know, this deck has been just really powerful in like most other matchups. And like, I don't necessarily feel like I'm favored against Hammer Time or anything, but this deck is just powerful and can, you know, outdraw or, you know, outmaneuver some of your opponents. So I think this has been a good job showcasing the deck. I like it. I'd recommend it. I do think there's some other ways to build it, but right now I'm pretty happy with this version, and I will see you guys later.